Hello everyone. So today I'm going to talk about deep learning, or at least an introduction to it, by presenting a algorithm which I consider to be the building blocks. And we'll see how it is the building blocks. And by the end, you'll see how you can take this algorithm and expand it out to make sort of deeper predictions. So who am I? I'm Jonathan Farrow. I started life as an electronics engineer. Initially working on sort of radios and very large sort of circuit boards. And then I moved into Rolls-Royce, where this is really where I began my product journey, sort of a technical product manager there. And then from there, I've sort of moved on through different companies and different products. And I think I've worked on some interesting products in my life. So I've designed parts for submarines, APIs to help with communications, the PlayStation 5, and sort of accounting software more recently. So yeah, very, very varied set of products that each have their own challenges, and that's what tends to make products interesting. So the agenda today, it's a very, very small agenda, but it's everything we're going to need to know, well, that sort of very intro for us to begin our journey as product managers into deep learning. So what are we going to be covering? Well, it's an algorithm called the perceptron algorithm. And this is considered to be the sort of simplest, you could say, sort of neural net. So a single perceptron that makes a prediction. And the way I want to cover that is, as you understand this, you can then begin to layer this concept to build more and more complex algorithms and neural nets. So it really truly is the foundation. And why do I think this is important for product managers to have an understanding of deep learning and sort of AI and just models in general and data? Well, as product managers, we are focused on user experience, we're focused on the business, but we're also focused on technology. So we need to understand what technology can do and see if there's opportunities for us to apply such technologies, or if there's certain situations where we can say, oh yes, maybe this algorithm could apply here, or this, we have a problem, maybe we can solve it in such a manner. So enable these sort of conversations and these thoughts to happen. So something key I said there is data. You would need to look at data and say, yes, this algorithm can be applied to it. And that tends to be the case for most algorithms, is they will suit a particular type of data. And the perception algorithm, for example, suits data that is sort of a binary output. What do I mean by that? So if you look at this sort of data here, we'd have sort of what we consider a pass and fail. And this could be relating to anything. This could be houses sold, houses did not sell. This could be a passing grade, failing grade. That doesn't matter. What we should concern ourselves with here is the output is of one and zero, that we have two sort of classifications here. Now we can apply the perception. Now it's suitable to apply the perception algorithm. And also something to note about when looking at this. So the y-axis and x-axis, there are predictors in this. So we have the pass and fail, and it seems to correspond to these two axes. So there are predictors. This is important to know. So what is a perceptron algorithm trying to do? Or if we wanted to make a prediction, what would we try and do to say if we were going to plot a new point in here that we think it was going to pass or fail? Well, we'll draw a line going across it and say anything above that line is a pass, or anything below it is a fail. So if I come along with a new point, such as 9.9 or 9.10, I could plot that on this and say, yes, it's above the line, I think this is a pass. I'm very, very confident that this is a pass. So that is in essence what our algorithm is going to try and do. It's going to try and establish this line. So then when we feed new data points in, it will be able to predict and say, look, it's above this line, so I predict this is a pass. So how do we draw that line? Well, this is probably an equation many of you have seen before, right? If you've ever done linear regression before, or just plotted a line on a graph, this is the equation you'll be familiar with. And for those who aren't, let me just go through it. So Y is your target, your prediction variable, often called Y hat, but just for simplicity's sake here, I'm calling it just Y. This is the target. So for us, this is the pass or fail. So is it above the line, below the line? So this is what's going to establish our line for us is using this equation. So the Y is our target. X is the predictors. So if you remember, I said on that previous graph, we had two predictors. And I'll come to that in a second because we seem to have one X here. So how do we put two X's in there? It's actually very, very, very simple. But before we get onto that, we have M and B. And what are they in this equation? Well, we'll consider those our model parameters, okay? They're actually what our algorithm is going to change and manipulate to try and alter the line. When M is the slope, and obviously the larger it is, the greater the rate of change, so the steeper the slope. And B is the intercept, that is where it crosses the y-axis. Okay. So I'll show some graph representations of that in a second, but that is all this really pertains to, right, is us finding these variables, and we can then begin to plot that line. So what's that equation below then? Well, this is just sort of in what we'll call sort of a machine learning representation for us, for our neural net. And you can see here I have x1 and x2. So what I've done here is because I have two predictors, two x variables, we'll say now, so we'll convert that y-axis into an x, I'm just adding that on to the equation. So what we're saying here is weight one, when W here is essentially M. I'm saying W1, X1, we'll times them together. But also the next predictor will have weight two, next two. And if we had a third one, we'd have W3, X3, and then always adding sort of the bias. So that's all we're doing. So it's a very, very simple equation. More, and just to reiterate, the more predictors you have, you just add them on, you just chain them on, and then we can begin making our predictions. Now, just to represent this in sort of graphical form, we can see here that when B is zero, it's going to cross the zero intercept point, right? W is now two, so our weight's two. You can see now the rate of change is going up quite steeply, it's doubling here. Now, if we move on to here where the intercept is 500, it's now intercepting the line here. So you can see how these parameters affect the line, okay? So this is just sort of a nice representation to show what the parameters are really doing. So how does this all fit into, you know, deep learning? Well, this is the perceptron, right? This is what we're going to be doing. This is the first neural net that we would be constructing. Okay. So taking our equation here, we would build our linear model. So we would have a graph with a line on that would exist in here, in this, what we'll call our perceptron node. That model now exists in there. We then feed in our inputs, our x1, our x2, and this is a one because this is going into our bias here. So we don't want to change that bias, but we'll just sort of times it by one. And this is going to feed into that linear model, and it's going to say, right, based on this x and this w, this x2 and this w, this should be w2, going into this linear model, where does that plot on that graph? And then it's going to, you know, output that, and then we're going to have something called a step function that will then convert that into a one or a zero, and say, right, if sort of above zero, one, below zero, zero, maybe something like that, this will then say if it's a pass or a fail. This is what the step function is doing. So that's all the perceptron algorithm is. So on the concept, very, very simple. So how do we get started with this? What needs to happen? Does the perception automatically have this model in there? No, it doesn't. Okay. So how do we get it to have that model learned? What do we have to do? Well, first of all, it's going to randomize those parameters. It's going to randomize the W's and the B. It's going to pick some random variables to begin with and say, right, I'll plot this line. Okay, good. This will usually have about an accuracy of, say, best 50-50. So when I put any of these points through, it might get some right, it might get some wrong. So it's not great right now, okay? We have our net, we've got some sort of random predicted sort of model here. We need to somehow make it change. We need to say, no, this line is incorrect, please change it. So then what we're doing is we'll feed the data through, and that point, as it goes through, will say, no, I'm misclassified. I am true, and you've predicted me as false. So just an example, so this point here would go through and say, but you've got me below the line, I'm true, you've predicted me as false. So what's it going to do? Well, we're going to, you know, correct it by this error. This is typically an error function. And how does this work for, say, a perception? What can we do? We can say, right, plus or minus the value of x, take it away from the weight. So, you know, based on if I'm above or below the line, how you've misclassified me, plus or minus me, away from the weight. And then, you know, adjust that variable as accordingly. And we'll do this for each point we feed through. Now, you're probably wondering, what is this sort of A-looking symbol here? Well, this is the learning rate. So this is something we're going to say, right, this is how much we want you to change. Okay, because if we were just saying take away the input value, we're going to get huge swings of that line, right? Because say it is maybe, you know, input value was 9. We're going to, that's a huge swing that we've taken away from W. So what we'll say is, let's apply a learning rate. This is how much we want, you know, a small change to happen. So the A might be something like, what, 0.01. So then we're going to times, therefore, at 0.01 by the predictor and take it away from the weight. So now we've made the change a lot smaller. So that means the line will change not as drastically. And this is good because we only want to make small changes and keep feeding this data through until we get a good line. If we have huge swings, then we could get stuck where the line is constantly moving up and down because it's stuck between points that have huge values. It's not moving small enough and making gradual changes till it finally finds its fit. That's why we want to introduce this sort of learning rate to it. And then we take that learning rate away from the bias as well. We do this for every point that we feed through this sort of simple network. And just to sort of illustrate how this happens, so this point here is saying, hey, you've misclassified me. Come closer to me. And the line does. That's what's nice about this function is that's as you feed it through, it's going to move the line closer to the point. Now this line saying, hey, you've also misclassified me. Please move me closer as well. And it now moves closer to that line. And we keep doing that until we have a line that fits, a line that is now, you know, is going to make a good prediction for us. Now we can estimate how good this prediction is by sort of looking at the sort of mean squared error. And when the sort of, well, when the mean squared error gets small enough, we can say, okay, our model is now good. So what is the sort of mean squared error? Well, what it is doing, it is taking all of the sort of errors, squaring them, and taken away from the mean. So you take each point away from the mean and then divide that by the number of points that there are. What this is then going to do is it will give you a value and it smooths out smaller errors and sort of penalizes you for large errors. So if the point is very far away, you'll be penalized more. And so as the mean squared error reduces, what you're now learning is you're saying, okay, when it gets to a small enough point, all right, we're now happy with this model. Okay. it's now, the error is now, it's small enough that it's giving a good enough prediction for us. So this is where sort of this will come into play for us. So we can sort of have an estimate of how good our model is, or when to stop sort of its predictions. Okay. So just to sort of visualize everything that is going on here, we have our data, and this might be multidimensional data as we've got here, with X1, X2, there could even be X3. So we have a sort of multidimensional plane. We'll build a model off of that. So that is our equation that we first put in. So we've now got a model. Now we're going to apply some error correction to that to say, you know, where is the line? Is it correct? Let's move it. Let's change these parameters. And then we're going to say, right, is the model good? You know, are we happy with the model now? Let's see if our error function is small enough to say yes, we are happy with that line fit. So this is really the beginnings of neural nets, this process here. Once we have this, we can start making predictions, feeding new points in, and making, yes, it's above the line, it's below the line. And that's the very sort of very beginning of deep learning, is this very simple neural net. Now, you can take this and expand it a level further. Just want to show that. You can do that by having multi-perceptron model. So now all the you have more nodes. So we have now two nodes, two model nodes here, two output nodes, and this is our input layer. So as you start adding more and more perceptrons, your models get more and more complex, and you can start predicting greater outputs and more complex models. So this is how a very simple perceptron model can start to build up into more and more complex models. And each of these inputs are then feeding in to these perceptron nodes, which are then going to give outputs. And these could be chained as well. That is an option. So you can start, how you then start modeling this, and how you start where, what inputs are feeding into what node, is where the next levels of complexity come in. But this is the basis of it. This is how that perception algorithm is the beginning of deep learning. So once you understand this, and once you can sort of grasp that it's just, first of all, predicting that line. Now let's make it more complex. So I hope this has sort of helped everyone on here. So just a grasp of like what the first step of deep learning is. What I would advise sort of everyone to do is try and find a data set out there. There are some sites that will provide that. Have a look at it and say, is this data correct? You know, is it of the binary format that is, you know, it's got two classes? Now, can I build a very simple perceptron? And I say go and do this because there's loads of code examples out there how to do it. And the code is 6 or 7 lines to build. And then you can start making predictions. So it is, as I said, very simple in the beginning to build this. And another factor, if you want to learn even more, so as we get into sort of the next stage of this, or more complex models, so where it's no longer, we can divide the data by a straight line. Maybe it's now a curved line. So we have to now apply some more advanced concepts. Well, I actually teach for product school. We go into deeper aspects of machine learning and how we can apply some of these factors. And if you are interested, please do check those classes out. But also if you would then like me to go into sort of a further lecture where we're going into, okay, non-linear models anymore, where the classification boundary is no longer straight, I'd be happy to make that next lecture. But first, please do try and, you know, have a go at coding this with a data set. And get comfortable with that before we move on to what will be the next concept. So just to summarize, the perception algorithm works on binary data. We'll randomize the parameters. The algorithm will then try and use an error function to learn the parameters and adjust the line. It will then output a binary 1 or 0 for its prediction. 1 and above the line, 0 and below the line. And that's how we would define, okay, which class is it stating. So I hope that was very clear for everyone. As I said, please do try and code this and reach out if you would like the next lectures, or look into the what Product School offers in terms of their courses. And why, yet again, I think it is important for product people to really sort of begin this journey of learning is just said, when you can look at a data set and say, right, we could potentially build a model to predict, make a prediction here, or do we have a question or a problem that we'd like to understand? Can we start to apply any models or algorithms to this to make that prediction for us and automate this? This is sort of where these conversations will come from. And will enable you as well to say, yeah, I think this is a route that's viable for us to take, and have also those conversations with ML engineers and sort of software engineers on about the feasibilities. So that is all from me, and I hope that was useful. Enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you.